Good morning.
Good morning.
Hey, it is a great morning, isn't it? I recall Dr. Nichols getting up here last week and him looking out across this humongous audience. It was humongous, wasn't it? And you know, his expression was, wow. That was great, Doc. We enjoyed that thoroughly. It is such a joy to welcome you all to the Guntersville Church of Christ this morning. I can't think of anything I'd rather be doing than worshiping our Savior, Jesus Christ, and especially today. And you all that are visiting with us, if you don't mind, if you'll reach and get the card out of the front pew and fill it out there and leave it there for us, that way we'll know to send you a little note of thank you for being with us this morning. Gee whiz, what a great week it's been. Can you think of many more ways to fix boiled eggs than we have done this past week? Have you tried them in boiled egg sandwiches? Do you toast your bread every time? How about using cornbread? Well, those eggs that you didn't find last week, you'll find when you mow next week. Absolutely. Today, Brother Bradley is going to talk with us about grace because he completed his series on Romans this past week. And I'll declare that made more new Christians, Brother Bradley. It did indeed. And us folks who already thought we were Christians really know it now after those wonderful messages. This morning's message has to do with grace. And when I saw that, I went to the thesaurus on the internet, and I looked up Christian quotes on grace. And one of my favorites is from a fellow named Zahl, Z-A-H-L. You may not know him because he writes a lot of radio script. But it was Paul Zahl who said that grace is unconditional love toward a person who does not deserve it. Pretty well sums it up, wouldn't you say? Absolutely. And speaking of grace, we got a member of our staff out at the radio station said, you know what? When it comes to table grace, that's one form of grace you may talk about this morning. I doubt it. But says, my wife's cooking is so bad, we pray after the meal. Thank you for worshiping with us. We got a wonderful service, and it's better because you are here.
Lord, we come before thee now.
Thank you. God and Father in heaven, you are the creator of the universe, and we stand in awe of your power. You are always in control, the giver of all good and perfect gifts, and we praise, honor, and adore you for all you do for us. Thank you for your mercy and your grace and the gift of your Son, which gives us hope. Please be with our congregation, be with those in need of physical or spiritual healing, and use us as your helping hands. Help us be the light of the world and reflect your love on all those around us. Give us the wisdom and courage to be better disciples and servants and do what is right. And now as we continue our worship to you, help us to do it with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. In Jesus' name we pray.
Jesus, you were all to me. Why did you die on Calvary? Oh, Lamb of God, I fail to see how good is he part of the plan. They say that you're alive again, but I'm
that to you at this time. Last week, of course, Dr. Nichols did such a great and eloquent job of really connecting the plan of God's salvation from Genesis through the crucifixion, through the resurrection, and for all eternity. I was at home watching the live stream recovering from gallbladder surgery, and I remember thinking, I feel really sorry for the guy that's got to follow up next week and get up here. Sure enough, here I am. But that's really what I want to talk about is the follow-up, what happened next. Jesus makes several what are kind of like little brief cameos. And in many situations, his disciples don't even realize it's him. And so I want to look at a particular example here in Luke 24, starting in verse 13. It says, "Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which is 7 miles from Jerusalem. They talked together of all these things which had happened. So it was while they conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. And he said to them, 'What kind of conversation is it that you have with one another as you walk and are sad?' Then the one whose name was Cleopas said, answered and said to him, 'Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem, and have you not known the things which happened there in these days?' And he said to them, 'What things?' So they said to him, 'The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who is a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb earlier astonished us when they did not find his body. They came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. Then he said to them, 'O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?' And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself." Pause for a second here. This point they still didn't know. He shared all this great knowledge as an all-knowing prophet. And this is not the moment that Jesus chose to reveal his true nature, his true self. We've seen other prophets, other mouthpieces of God, but this is not the moment yet, because clearly this is not another prophet. This is God. So verse 28, "And they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone farther, but they constrained him, saying, 'Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent.' He went in to stay with them. Now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, 'Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us?' So they rose up that very hour, returned to Jerusalem, and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon.' And they told him about the things that had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread." So interesting, as he entered someone else's house and he was their honored guest, how quickly he sat down with bread and he broke it, and he immediately went from the guest to the gracious host. And that's when they knew. Again, he could have revealed himself at any point, and he chose at that moment to let them know that God and his grace are now the host. You know, we sometimes invite people to our church and our service, and it's okay, we sometimes, you know, say it, put it that way, but we know who the host is here today. We know this is the church that belongs to Jesus Christ, and we know that it was his grace that purchased this church. And we know, as we break bread, it of course his utmost intention that we truly see and know him and remember his grace while we do it. So if you would bow with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you sent your Son to earth to not just be our Redeemer, but be our gracious host forevermore. And Father, we thank you so much that he revealed himself to us and continues to reveal himself so that we can, of course, have this hope of eternal salvation to be your guest in heaven one day. It's Christ's name we pray. Amen. Bow with me again. Holy Father, as we continue to partake in this memorial, we want to be mindful of the blood that was shed for our sins, how the innocent shed his blood for the guilty. And Father, we just can't thank you enough for the power of love and, of course, the power of your grace. In Christ's name. Bowing one more time as we remember our material blessings. Father, in a similar manner, we thank you so much for just the daily blessings that you give us, for the country we have, for our occupations, our jobs, our livelihood. And Father, there's never been a country so blessed as ours. So Father, we pray that we will do what we can to give back. And Father, we just want to ask that you just continue to bless us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
While we sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, if you will please stand with me. Our children will be dismissed to children's worship while we sing this song.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that
chapter 7, verses 41 through 43 says, "Then Jesus told him this story. A man loaned money to two people, 500 pieces of silver to one and 50 pieces to the other. But neither of them could repay him, so he kindly forgave them both, canceling the debts. Who do you suppose loved him more after that?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one who he canceled the larger debt." "Jesus, that's right," Jesus said.
Thank you, Charlie. If you will, leave your Bibles open there to Luke chapter 7. We're going to be turning there in a moment. And I appreciate Brad Howard filling in for me Wednesday night because, believe it or not, my voice was worse then. Couldn't talk at all Wednesday, which is not a bad thing for some. But I talked to Greg Driscoll at lunch on that Wednesday. He said, and I thought, well, I'm glad I didn't give a $40 copay for this. He goes, "Just don't talk. Just don't talk." So I've tried to adhere to that, but that's tough to do on Sunday. And by Thursday, I could talk a little bit, but my voice kept cracking, and I'm reminded of a reference that the late, great Irma Bombeck made in one of her books. She said something about her husband was ill, and his voice cracked like one of the Hardy Boys asking the judge for the keys to the Packard. And so that's a dated reference, but must have been pretty descriptive. And I appreciate Jim Herring, his compassion this morning. He said, "Well, you know, your voice is back enough to give us about 15 minutes this morning." So always in my corner, Jim. I appreciate it. But I do want to introduce, as Bruce mentioned, a kind of a continuation to our series that I closed out 2 weeks ago from the book of Romans. And the book of Romans, and here again, I said this kind of as a disclaimer every week, we didn't try to cover the whole letter because there's so much in there. And we've got this Sunday and a couple of Sundays, and then as the bulletin reveals, it'll be Senior Sunday. And that launches us into just one continued event all the way through the summer. So from the standpoint of a series, I've got a couple of weeks here that what I'd like to do is build on what we talked about in the book of Romans, but then go to the Gospels and see where Jesus illustrates or models some of the principles that we talked about in that series in the book of Romans. Today, from Luke chapter 7, we model some of those principles that Paul talked about in Romans chapter 6 and in chapter 8 about what do you do, how are you going to deal with sin in your life, particularly recurring sin. In fact, in Romans chapter 3 and verse 20, if you remember, Paul writes, and this is one of the primary purposes of him writing that letter. He said, "No one will be declared righteous in his sight, specifically by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of sin." So you know, Paul starts out in the book of Romans reminding his Jewish audience, the law was in and of itself was not the goal. It was given to convict us of sin. And so I think now, since we've studied that, we look at how God counters that. I like John 1, verse 17. There, Jesus said, "For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ," John tells us. And the good news that we try to emphasize every week is that we're not saved by trying to keep a network or a litany of laws perfectly. Under for the Jews, it was the law of Moses. They couldn't do it. It was not designed for that. And once we understand the truth that we're saved by completely putting our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and ultimately, as Russ mentioned, it's his grace that brings about our salvation. Once we understand that, then we receive his forgiveness and we walk in a confident obedience day in and day out. So I've selected some incidences in the Gospels, one today and then one next week, and then Lord willing the following week, because here's the contention, and every time you read the Gospels, you need to be reminded of this, that no one could come in contact with Jesus and stay the same. It just didn't happen. And we're going to look at some people that were, boy, they were riffed with problems and issues, but they couldn't be around him for very long and something not change. So in the seventh chapter of the book of Luke, we see today's story. The story, of course, centers around an incident where Jesus is in the home of Simon, a Pharisee, and in the course of that time, a woman comes in. And of course, that just, ushers in this entire incident. Verse 36, one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, so he went to the Pharisee's house, reclined at the table. And you realize that the Leonardo da Vinci's painting of the Last Supper is completely European. That was nothing like what the setting and the structure and the furniture would have been like in a Jewish home. And so probably in a U-shaped, and Jesus and everyone else would have been reclined at the table. Their feet would have been toward the back of the room. And, the visitor would be served the meal, or the guest would be. But usually, in some instances, the front door would have been left open. Someone could come in off of the street and come through the courtyard. And if it was a visiting teacher, the thought was people could sit and they could listen to the conversation, listen to the teacher, and learn and observe what's going on. And so that was basically the setup. Verse 37. A woman who had lived a sinful life, the Bible says, in that town, learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, and she brought an alabaster jar of perfume. Now, don't confuse this with when Mary, the sister of Martha and Lazarus, would do something similar to this in John 12. This is a totally different incident. They're very similar, but they're different. Verse 38, the woman stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and she began to wet his feet with her tears. And then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. Now, I don't know about you, but I can't read that text without it making me just a little bit uncomfortable. I mean, you're embarrassed for her. You're embarrassed maybe for Jesus. Maybe there's a cathartic embarrassment for anybody who was there. But I think that's the point. Now, we don't know much other than what Luke tells us about this woman. He uses the phrase, translations might vary, but that she was a sinful woman known in that town. So consequently, most Bible scholars conclude that she was probably a prostitute. But she may have had some other issue that was going on. But anyway, her reputation was known there in that town. So she was a sinful woman, but she was also, I think, a seeking woman. Woman, you might say. When she learned that Jesus was there, she goes. And there, of course, she has opportunity to come in contact with him. We also realize that she was penitent in this sense. You know, there's an old Turkish proverb that says, no matter how far you've gone down the wrong road, turn back. And that makes good sense. And this woman was determined, evidently she was determined to turn back. I take it she had probably heard Jesus teach somewhere, and as she knew of his compassion, she knew of his love, and she knew that he was a friend to everyone. And being in the presence of Jesus that day, all of the characteristics that we see about him is on display. Now, it's difficult, as I said a while ago, to read this, and she weeps. In fact, here again, your translations are rather interesting. The NIV says, she stood behind his feet weeping, and she began to wet his feet with her tears. Now, I don't know about you, but if there was so much, her tears were so, the volume was to the degree that it wet his feet, that's not weeping. I don't know if the English uses the right word. To me, that is uncontrollable sobbing. You know, you've been around people that can do that. They can shed a tear, but they look like they're big old crocodile tears, that kind of stands out. But there are others that it's a continuous. And so this is not a situation where she just kind of walks up and, you know, sheds a tear. No, this is uncontrollable sobbing. And to the point that it wets his feet, she can dry his feet with her hair, and then she pours that perfume on his hair. And here again, this is another interesting reference. In that day, it was considered immodest for a woman to appear in public with loose hair. It was supposed to be bound up. But this woman was so expressive in her situation that she wets his feet with her tears, she dries them with her hair, and then, of course, anoints his feet with the perfume. And I love the way Jesus responds. And here again, as uncomfortable and maybe melodramatic as many of us would have been in that situation, Jesus, of course, was not the least bit affected by it. But look at verse 39. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Now, we don't have time this morning to really, explore that whole thing. It kind of gives us a little inkling as to why Simon would have invited Jesus to his home to begin with. If Simon's motivations were not above board, then this might be some indication of this. Let me say something a little bit about the Pharisees. Keep in mind that when Simon took a vow to be a Pharisee, he promised to obey the letter of the law. His whole life would then be devoted to living not only according to just the Ten Commandments, but all of the Old Testament. Now, what's the great irony of that? He didn't do it. How do we know? Nobody could. Paul had already, would later say that in the book of Romans. And so although outwardly the Pharisees were, maybe for the most part were good people, they usually had a very deep problem attitude-wise. And that is they were self-reliant, they were arrogant, and especially judgmental. In fact, 6 times in Matthew 23, Jesus called them what? Hypocrites. That's pretty direct. 6 times. And you remember in John 8, it was the Pharisees that brought the woman taken in the act of adultery to Jesus and suggested that what? That she be stoned. And so there's a lack of compassion. There's a lack of grace here. And I think that's the contrast that this incident draws to us. And so Jesus responds to this because he knew what Simon was thinking. And we get at the text that Charlie just read. 2 men owed money to the certain money lender. One owed him 500 and the other 50. Now watch this. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he canceled the debts of both. And Bruce had a great definition of grace. I've heard a couple of others, but I think this is one that's right in the context of this. and that is canceling the debt. He canceled the debt of both, and then he asked the question, now which of them loved him more? Now, Jesus not only knew the woman's reputation, right? He also knew what Simon was thinking. The Bible says he knew what was in the heart of all men. And so he knew that while the woman was guilty of any number of sins, Simon's guilty as well. They're both spiritually bankrupt, I think is what Luke is drawing out of this. Neither one of them are capable of paying back their debt. You see how the parable that Charlie read parallels what's already happened in this incident. You got one that owed 500, that's who? Well, that's the sinful woman. You got another one that owes 50, that's who? That's Simon. Both are guilty, and neither one can pay. And so Jesus said in the parable, he forgave the debt of both. Now, Simon gets the parable, but he doesn't get it, right? He doesn't see where he himself is in the story. And so, verse 43, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled. Jesus said, you judged correctly. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. William Barclay, in his commentary, points out that a host would do three things when guests would come into his home. Three acts of kindness, one of which was you would give them the kiss of peace. You've seen this in movies from Bible incidences where they would kiss on either side of the cheek. That was the kiss of peace. Secondly, they would provide a basin of water for the feet to be washed. Either a servant would do that, or maybe one of the children of the host would wash the feet of the guest. But at least, if you didn't have either one of those, you at least had the water and a towel where guests would come in and at least wash their own feet. And third, they would, after that, they would take some type of incense or a drop of perfume and place it on the guest's head. That was just considered common courtesy. Simon does none of this. And in fact, verse 45, Jesus says what? You gave me no kiss, but this woman, from the time that I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You put no oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, here's the point. Her many sins have been forgiven before she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little. Now, I don't know if you underline in your Bibles, but underline all of it, but especially double underline that last phrase. He who has been forgiven little loves little. You know, I don't know about you, but I've observed that people who come to Christ from a very difficult background, from a very worldly background, unlike some of us who our third, fourth generation believers, a lot of first generation believers that have tremendous conversion stories, that they seem to be more appreciative and more expressive because they remember where they were before. And verse 48, Jesus said, your sins are forgiven. He says this to the woman, similar to what happened in John 8, right? Your sins are forgiven, and then everybody else at the tables did what? Well, there's that grumbling, that mumbling. Who is this who even forgives sins? And Jesus said to the woman, watch this again, your faith has saved you, go in peace. Now, what's the contrast? Simon saw this woman coming off the street as a nuisance, as a source of embarrassment. Jesus saw just the opposite. And he takes that as an opportunity to really try to bring Simon and anybody else there, bring them back into perspective. So what's this story about? It's about grace, obviously. But what predicates that is something that we didn't talk much about. We did a little bit in the 8th chapter of the book of Romans. But I think it's one of those things that we have to constantly reiterate, because it's one of those areas that in the modern world especially, Christians seem to struggle with more and more. And that has to do with this concept of forgiveness. And because Jesus told this woman what? Your sins are forgiven. And the fact that he would take it upon himself to say that, instead of it generating a positive discussion among the people at the table as to, well, good, you know, how can he do that? They immediately wrote it off. You know, and so let's just talk about that for a little bit this morning. We've said in the past, it doesn't matter where we are in the text, anytime the subject of forgiveness comes up, you know, everybody comes at it with different levels of understanding and different levels of experience. It's been my experience that there's probably been more through the history of our movement, there's probably been more poor theology that has developed over, I think, a misunderstanding of forgiveness than anything else. What we tend to do, instead of taking, you know, biblical principles and illustrations and directives about forgiveness and embracing those, we neutralize it with our own concepts and our own experiences. We come up with some rather interesting characteristics of it, like, well, I don't have to forgive people if they don't ask me. Really? Now, what text of Scripture says that? Or, I can't forgive them unless I can forget what they did. Again, what text of Scripture says that? Now, I don't mean to minimize. Please hear me. I don't want to minimize hurt. I don't want to minimize situations that have happened in your life that today you still bear the scars of that. I'm not trying to minimize that. But at the same time, I'm wanting you to see that sometimes we put so many characteristics and so many conditions on forgiveness that nobody can do it consistently. And yet here Jesus is, first time encounter, and he can say without a shadow of a doubt, your sins are forgiven. And the end, he says what? It's your faith that saved you. So what do we do? Well, I've got some practical applications that I think help. And here again, what's the issue? The issue is when we realize, hopefully, that we come to the point that Paul mentions in the book of Romans, that we're all sinners. Remember when we were talking about the discussion on tolerance, one of the first components of that is you got to look in the mirror. You got to look and say, okay, well, where's my blind spot? And this is the classic example of what Simon did not do. Simon, you know, immediately goes to the sin of this woman, and Jesus said her sins that are many, but what had Simon evidently not done? He hadn't looked in the mirror. He hadn't looked to say, okay, what's the beam in my eye before I try to denote the speck in somebody else's eye? So how do we do that? Well, the first application is simply this. We go where Jesus is. You know, the first thing we need to do when you feel like just avoiding coming in contact with anything of a spiritual nature because of this, you know, that this woman could have done that. She knew what her sin was. She knew what her situation was. But instead of avoiding that, she's drawn to it. And, you know, when you and I realize that we've sinned, we need to go to the place where you're most likely to be made aware of it, but at the same time, given solutions. But what happens a lot of times is, in the modern era especially, people don't want to do that. They don't feel like going to church. They don't feel like reading Scripture. They don't feel like praying. But it's kind of like taking medicine when you're sick. It's counter to feelings, but it's what's needed. So the first step in this whole process is you go where Jesus is. You know, the prodigal son, if anybody, you know, in Luke 15, he was so hurt, so desperate, that he finally said what? I'll go back to my father. And again, you know, we could come up with other examples. All right, very quickly. Number two, we need to allow ourselves to be overwhelmed by this love. This is a love. Go back to jot down Romans 5 and verse 8. There Paul said, if you want to know God's love for you, then you look at what? Exactly what Russ was talking about a while ago. You look at Jesus' death on the cross. Because when Jesus died on the cross, since he was God in the flesh, he could look to the future. He could see the day when you and I were born, would be born, and he could also see the day that we die. And he knew the cumulative factor of all of our sin, and he said, I'm going here to die for all those commandments that you've broken. This is Romans 3, remember? All of them. And so you want to know how much God loves you. Well, he has taken all of your hurts, all of your indiscretions, all of the punishments that should have resulted in your condemnation, and Jesus took that to the cross. Ephesians 3, Paul would say, if you could grasp how wide and how long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you might be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. That's it. A third key. And I think this a third key to repentance is a genuine, a key to forgiveness is a genuine repentance of your sin. You look at the situation. This woman was sincerely repentant for what she'd done. How do you know? One commentator points this out, and I've got to go back and look at it. And he said the fact that she took that perfume and poured that on his feet. He said in that day and time, if she was in fact a prostitute, perfume was one of the tools of that trade. And so she poured all of it on his feet. It's as if she was saying, I'm not going to need this anymore. I'm done with this. And if that's true, then you know, that's pretty thorough. When we think about this idea, and you hear people say all the time, you read it, you study it, that God loves you in spite of your sin, and we praise God for that. And all that's true, but Jesus said, if you don't repent, then what? Well, then you're going to perish. And so, repentance is a key component to this whole idea of forgiveness. And let me add, and I didn't have this on the PowerPoint because I thought about it a little bit later, that there's what makes forgiveness such an interesting and such a complex reality is that there is a direct connection in me acknowledging and experiencing God's forgiveness in a vertical sense. It's directly related to what? To horizontal forgiveness. Here's the interesting aspect of this. If you're not willing to forgive other people, you're not going to fully grasp and fully understand God's forgiveness. It works both ways. It's just not possible. And so one of the reasons why I would ask the question, is grace really all that amazing? It isn't to those who don't extend it. No, it's not amazing to those who doesn't think it's possible. And the other aspect of this is forgiveness is here again, we put all these conditions on it. But in reality, you know, the hardest person for you to forgive is you. And again, it's because of a lot of these requirements, if you will. I think repentance involves three words. The first word is conviction. Conviction is when you say, I'm wrong. Now, right there, you basically lost three-fourths of our culture. We're not big in American culture with saying, you know what, I was wrong. We'll say, my bad. What does that mean anyway? My bad. Why don't you just say, I was wrong? Same thing, I get it. But you think about, you know, that's a major, major statement. I'm not a victim of my heredity. It's not because of my environment. I've made wrong choices. Right? That's conviction. The second word is contrition. Oh boy, I'm sorry. That's a tough one. We're not geared to saying that either. I'm sorry. Because I've wounded the heart of God and I've hurt other people with my actions. And then the third word is change. I'm going to turn back. Now, true repentance involves all three of these, and you don't pick and choose. You got to take them all. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. Worldly sorrow brings death. Godly sorrow turns us around. So that's the third component. Very quickly, the number four, trust in God's amazing grace. Trust in that. Jesus says to this woman, your sins are forgiven. Your faith has saved you. He didn't say your penance has saved you. If you'll do 400 hours of community service, I'll save you. No, her forgiveness was granted instantly by what? By the purpose of his grace. Jot down Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9. It's by grace that you've been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It's the gift of God. And God says, you put your faith and you put your trust in me, I'll save you. And he wants us to believe in that. And so we put our faith and we put our trust in that. And then the final one is, okay, based on that fourth one, live like you believe you're forgiven. And I think this is really, really the struggle. And that is, live in such a way that we believe forgiveness has happened. Now, interestingly, Jesus said to this woman, now go in peace. Jesus wanted her to have that assurance and the peace that she was forgiven. Now, did she live a perfect life after that? Nope. I doubt it. But she was moving in the right direction. And the Lord wanted her to be confident in that, you know, based on that promise. Now, here again, we talked about this back several weeks ago. Grace is not to be exploited. You go back to Romans 6, and there Paul, you know, anticipates that. You're not. It's not some kind of a credit card for you to do like you want. But God wants you to live a life that's confident and a full assurance. You don't live a life where you're intimidated by the world. I wonder if I'm saved. I wonder if my sins are forgiven. No, he wants us to be at peace. He wants us to have a clear understanding that when he has forgiven us, we're forgiven. I like what John says in 1 John 5 and verse 13. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. Even though we're not perfect, we're forgiven. And we don't have to kind of sneak in and sneak out of church. We can walk out knowing that we serve a God of graceful mercy and forgiveness. And anything that we have done, anything that we've experienced, he's forgiven us for that. And this grace is so marvelous. One writer put it this way. He took my biggest failure and one of my biggest sins, and he turned it all around. And as a result, I can do what he wants me to do. And so the answer is yes. That grace is absolutely amazing. Our salvation is totally dependent upon the graciousness of God, because he loves us the way we are. And we're going to sing a closing song to give you an opportunity to respond to that love. And if you've never done that, you don't know, what to, you say, well, I don't know what to expect. He's going to forgive you. He's going to transform you. He's going to take those weaknesses and make them his strengths, and then he will begin to live through you. And we give you an opportunity to respond to that love and that salvation this morning, if you'll come while we stand together and while we sing.